Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. As we continue the long march through March, and the GPU situation continues to relentlessly kick us all in the balls, even the most stalwart and diehard PC gamer might begin to lose hope. And while part of me wants to say, sure, yeah, let's just give up on hope and the whole PC gaming thing, it had a good run, another part of me is an intractable and relentless contrarian, and when told something is a certain way, my response is, nuh-uh. There are perfectly good reasons to keep up hope for GPU pricing to normalize. We just need some patience and a steadfast refusal to buy at marked up prices, which we'll discuss today along with other momentous revelations from the past week, such as the best and fastest CPU ever launching, and Intel finally moving on from their tumultuous Gelsinger affair, spotted gallivanting with a hot new bae. Ooh. It's been a long winter, so let's greet spring together on this episode of Tech News. Cheers.
Excellent.
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's TR100 Mini Tower Case and Travel Trunk. The TR100 is a diminutive but full-featured dual-chamber chassis with a surprisingly roomy interior for high-end PC builds, available in a variety of colors with support for up to 360mm GPUs and a 280mm AIO radiator on top. The modular design means side panels are all removable for cable management, and upgrades include an optional LCD panel or the travel trunk to easily take your TR100 gaming PC setup on the go. For more on the TR100 mini tower case from Thermaltake, check out my build or click the sponsor link in the video description. Intel's Core Ultra Series CPUs didn't really need any more nails in their coffin, but AMD supplied them nonetheless with Wednesday's launch of the 16-core Ryzen 9 9950X3D and 12-core 9900X3D. AMD seems to have worked out the two CCD scheduling issues that hampered the 7950X3D, as the 9950X3D is able to properly park its non-X3D enhanced die in order to behave like an 8-core 9800X3D when gaming. Almost, with most reviews showing near parity in gaming between the 8-core and 16-core, with the 9950X3D falling 2 or 3% behind in some tests, or coming in just ahead if you look at the Hardware Unboxed video. At the same time, in multi-threaded productivity workloads, the 9950X3D routinely outperforms Intel's Core Ultra 285K and 14900K while drawing less power. It doesn't win across all tests. Intel does still have situational advantages, but on average it was 11% faster than the 285K, while also matching or sometimes beating the 9950X without the 3D per Tom's Hardware. Hardware Unboxed Steve also tested Eco Mode, the green bar on these charts, which does reduce performance somewhat, but can also reduce power draw, sometimes by more than 50%. There. Right there. So despite its somewhat pricey $700 price tag, the 9950X3D has received recommendations from many reviewers as the best all-around chip for a multi-use desktop PC. On the other hand, Leo from KitGuru took a look at the $100 less 12-core 9900X3D and found that the dip from 8 cores per CCD to 6 noticeably impacted performance. Even AMD's charts show the 9900X3D having a rough time keeping up, and while it isn't terrible or anything, it's 3/4 of the cores for 6/7 of the price. The 9950X3D just looks much better by comparison and doesn't behave like a 6-core when gaming, but probably this was part of AMD's sales plan, and when they eventually drop the 9900X3D to $450 or $500 later this year, we'll all start calling it AMD's underappreciated hidden gem. Moving back over to uncomfortable GPU news, we're about 10 days out from the RTX 5070 and Radeon RX 9070 and 9070 XT launches, so let's see what perspective a little time has gained us. Sadly, but as expected, the base price cards for all three GPUs that launched sold out immediately, so anything currently available is significantly marked up over MSRP, which has led to a series of content pieces lamenting fake MSRP and how gamers have been misled. I thought Tim's video did a good job explaining the difference between the two launches. With Nvidia, pricing was announced early, but supply was and still is very much constrained. They just aren't delivering enough new GPUs. With the AMD Radeon launch though, the RX 9070 and 9070 XT GPUs, supply started to arrive at retailers pretty early, back in December and January, but pricing wasn't announced until much later, about a week before launch, meaning many retailers paid higher prices than MSRP based on early price expectations. AMD thankfully decided to lower their MSRPs, but they were supposed to offer rebates to those retailers who had already paid the higher prices to cover the price difference, and it seems AMD has only done that with some of the GPUs that were sold, resulting in retailers selling their first batches of inventory for the price that they originally paid, which was well above MSRP. Even some of the stock that just recently arrived in the first week or so after launch might have been paid for under pre-existing agreements, but the upshot is that while this is just one of many factors impacting the retail price of video cards, and there's definitely shady stuff happening as well, there is hope that as more GPUs are produced and as retailers restock with updated pricing based on the actual MSRP, the influx of inventory will begin to normalize pricing and we might see the return of $600 RX 9070 XTs. It's certainly been shown that there were more Radeon 9000 series cards put up for sale last week than RTX 50 series cards, 5070 in particular, with this computer based poll indicating more than half of new GPUs were 9070s and 9070 XTs. AMD Vice President David McAfee said demand for these new GPUs has been unprecedented, and at least he's saying that getting more GPUs onto store shelves is top priority. Hopefully that's not just lip service. And even Nvidia is attempting to congratulate themselves for shipping twice as many RTX 50 series GPUs in the first 5 weeks versus the RTX 40 series back when that launched. Except they forgot to mention that in this same 5 week period, the 50 series had four GPUs launched, 5090, 5080, 5070 Ti, and 5070, while the RTX 40 series had only one, the RTX 5090. Gosh, and for a moment, I thought this chart from Nvidia wasn't going to be deceptive and misleading. Here's a much better chart, the Meta Review compilation for 5070 versus 9070 and 9070 XT reviews, assembled by community champion Voodoo2SLI over on Reddit. This is the kind of perspective we like a week or two post-launch, given variants in testing and settings used across different tech outlets. But if we scroll right down to the at-a-glance section, where the 5070 is being used as the 100% baseline, we can see that the 9070 is about 6 to 8% faster in raster performance, while the 9070 XT is more like 17 to 23% faster. Meanwhile, when ray tracing is included, the 9070 falls behind by about 1 to 6.5%, while the 9070 XT is 6.5% ahead still at 1080 and 1440, and 17.3% ahead at 4K, where the 5070 begins to struggle due to its 12GB memory limitation. There's lots of data compiled here, so check the link in the description if you'd like to take a closer look. Meanwhile, over in Intel land, they have at last found a new CEO, and his name is Lip-Bu Tan, and he starts Tuesday. Time will tell if Mr. Tan will provide us with any memeable moments like ousted former CEO Pat Gelsinger or those lovable goofball interim co-CEOs David Zinsser and Michelle Johnston Holthaus. But investors at least seem cautiously optimistic that Tan will bring the experience and understanding of both the chip design and fabrication side of the business necessary to write Intel's heavily listing ship. Tan was previously on Intel's board from 2022 to 2024 and has worked for Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, SMIC, and Cadence Design Systems, where he was CEO from 2009 to 2021. And per his posting to the Intel press site Wednesday, he plans to stay humble, work hard, and delight our customers. But also that it will not be easy. Tan clashed with ex-CEO Gelsinger about what he perceived as bloat and inefficiency in Intel's management structure, so the expectation is that more job cuts will be coming in the future to make a leaner Intel. But time will tell if they actually manage to root out inefficient middle managers and layers of bureaucracy, or if more innocent, hardworking Intellians get the boot simply to please Wall Street investors. As PC gamers, we surely want Intel to remain in contention as AMD Ryzen CPU competition at the very least, but the biggest fear on the gaming side at the moment is that the Arc GPU program, which was a pet project of Gelsinger's, gets axed or seriously scaled back to the point where we're back to two players in the discrete GPU market. At the very least, it appears Intel will be bringing an Arrow Lake refresh to market, if leaker Golden Pig upgrade is to be believed, and this time with more AI. Because that's what everyone really asked for when the Core Ultra 200 series launched. Hey Intel, more mediocre CPUs, please, but we could also really use more AI, because the world is not fully permeated with that yet. Speaking of full permeation, have you really absorbed all the tech news without tech briefs? The 9800X3D is widely recognized as the best CPU option for a gaming PC, but no piece of hardware can exist without lingering doubts these days, which is why some 9800X3Ds have been dying. Not a lot. just enough to give you a little bit of doubt and uncertainty. And you know what? It's just those ASRock X870 boards that are doing it, so no big deal, really. Except maybe MSI too. Per a report from Reddit, realistic_age_718 had a perfectly functional MSI X870E Tomahawk Wi-Fi build until they enabled EXPO, and then pop! Their system refused to boot, and their 9800X3D developed a telltale bulge under the contact pads. ASRock acknowledged and supposedly fixed this problem a week or two ago with a BIOS update, as it was reportedly occurring with their X870 and X870E boards, but it's worth keeping tabs on if this problem becomes more widespread. For now, there are still only a handful of reports of 9800X3Ds failing in this way. Speaking of a telltale bulge, AMD investors likely got a bit of a semi this week when it was announced that Oracle is buying 30,000 MI355X GPUs, initially, as part of an expansion of their data center and AI business. And we wonder where all the GPU supply is going. But while PC gamers might lament news of this nature, since it's clearly taking away from the quantity of GPU dies that would otherwise be available for gaming GPUs, we should also feel some sympathy for Oracle, because they are lamenting GPU component delays as well. As much fab capacity as AI has consumed, they're still hungry for more. We don't have a whole lot of reason to be excited for NVIDIA's presumed next GPU launches, the 5060 and 5060 Ti, as rumored, but they will likely happen regardless. And since they're rumored to be announced soon, we might as well suggest that it could happen this week. Jensen will be on stage Wednesday to deliver a keynote at GTC, the GPU technology conference that NVIDIA puts on a couple times a year, taking place in San Jose, California from March 17th to 21st. There will likely be ad nauseum discussion about AI and AI-specific hardware, but given that Jensen does like to make announcements on stage, this is the soonest likely event where he might also provide some confirmation and details about the 5060, 5060 Ti, maybe even the 5050. Speaking of GTC, the GPU Technology Conference taking place in San Jose, California from March 17th to 21st, GDC, the Game Developers Conference, will be taking place just one city over in San Francisco, also from March 17th to 21st this week. What a coincidence. NVIDIA plans to make announcements there too, and we'll come back next week to cover anything noteworthy that was revealed. It might be new GPUs and previously unknown information, or it might just be rehashing of some of the latest neural rendering and AI advancement supercharging game development that they already showed off at CES, only we can view them with the properly jaded perspective now since we know the actual pricing and availability of the RTX 50 series GPUs. And on that note, if I can circle back to my intro theme, remember to be patient and don't pay scalper prices for the RX 9070s or RTX 50 series, and hopefully we'll see more reasonably priced cards for sale sometime soon. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone. Cheers. We'll see you next week.